apple is. But when I have an idea and you have an idea, and once we exchange them, we both have two ideas each. So for me, sui generis is this. Thank you very much for this. And with this, I go into my presentation. Yes, the title of my presentation is The Danger of a Single Story, a Critical Analysis. So throughout this presentation, I would be having a kind of stylistic approach. So basically, The Danger of a Single Story is not a published work. It's a TED talk by Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, a Nigerian author, and this is the source visible on the screen. And this TED talk was delivered in July 2009 in Houston, London. And the duration of this particular talk is 18 minutes and 12 seconds. So it's not a long talk, yet the kind of influence it has, it wields on the authors and the readers of English literature is enormous. We can see this by the viewership. So it has received 2 crore 77 lakh plus views. So that shows the popularity of this TED talk. Now, who is this person in discussion? So Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie is a Nigerian author and a very powerful voice in the realm of feminism. And the very first work by her is Purple Hibiscus, a very famous female Bildungsroman. Female Bildungsroman is a kind of a novel which depicts the development of a girl. Basically, when we read literature, you have read Charles Dickens, David Copperfield. There you see the development of a boy from his childhood to adulthood. So it's a kind of journey. But there are very few books on the journey of a girl's development. So Purple Hibiscus is a wonderful work. Now, Half of Us, Yellow Sun is a work against the background of Biafran War, like when Nigeria became free in 1962. Thereafter, Biafra, some provinces of southern part of Nigeria, went for secession, and there was a kind of civil war. So it's written against that background. And the third one is Americana. It shows the struggle and the painful journey of a non-American, rather an African person in America for education. And the character, the protagonist, Ifemelu, here in Americana, is the alter ego of Adichie. The fourth work is The Thing Around Your Neck. This is a story collection. And the next next two books, We Should All Be Feminists, and Dear Isabel, A Feminist Manifesto in 15 Suggestions, are two critical essays by her. And the last one is Notes on Grief. It's a very recent one, basically after the death of her father. So this was a kind of brief introduction to the author and her work. Now, apart from all these writings, she is very active on web platforms, TED Talks, and other media, and she gives lectures, and she holds training programs from young and budding authors. So now, I would like to come to come to the text. Like in modern criticism, we say that text is autotelic. Text tells everything. But when we see it from the stylistic perspective, every word has special meaning. Every phrase is full of or pregnant with enormous amount of thought. So we will start like that. So this is basically, since it is a talk, it does not have a written structure, but I have borrowed the transcript from one of the websites, and I would go with that. So it starts with the very first sentence, I am a storyteller. So this is a simple sentence, but at the same time, it is a kind of, professing one's identity that I am not a doctor, I am not an engineer, I am a storyteller. And this is my task. And it is a direct address you, that I'm involving you. And I would like to tell you few personal stories. So it reminds us of Charles Lamb. Charles Lamb was the first, essayist who, like if you have studied English literature, that he was the first author who had introduced personal essays. So it's a kind of creating or establishing a rapport with the author, that I'm going to tell you a few personal stories. And it is regarding the danger of the single story. Now, when we say single story, both the words start with sir sound. So in English phonetics, sir is called sibilant. Sibilant sounds like sir, sher, and zer, these are, and zher, right? So these sounds are called sibilant, and they have a very wonderful quality of musicality. They give you a kind of melody in the language. And at the same time, they make you, the discourse becomes very, rhetorical. And after this, the speaker declares that I grew up on a university campus in Eastern Nigeria. Why is this important? Words of W.J. Long, an author, like a book, behind the book, there is a man, and behind the man, there is religion, there is a belief, there is a culture. So one cannot, escape from this reality. So she cannot escape from this reality that she grew up in Nigeria. That is her real identity. And she recalls that how her reading habit started at a very early age. Like she says that she started reading at 2, but she corrects that probably 4 was the correct age. And, she developed the discourse with another intensifier. So, means with this background, I go ahead. So it is a kind of intensifier. Like I'm intensifying my conversational tone. And here she says that she grew up reading the British and American children's books because she did not have any other book to her disposal. Right? When we talked about English medium schools, these were the only literature, children's book available to them. And the next thing she talks about, now there is a shift from reading to writing, right? So reading is consuming and writing is producing, reception and production. Now she discusses her identity as a writer and her action as right. So there is a repetition. So whenever there is a repetition, so there is a kind of emphasis on that particular skill, right? So how did she write? With pencil crayons. And who was the reader? The mother. Because nobody else would read that. So she was a writer from her childhood, and she had a reader in the form of a mother. And now, what did she write? She wrote exactly the same thing she consumed, exactly the same thing she perceived, exactly the same thing she got from the books, where the characters were white, blue-eyed, and they played in snow. They ate apples. And these expressions had nothing to do with her native surrounding, native environment, because she lived in Nigeria. Nigeria, as you know, the climate, the geography is a hot country, right? And here you see, we didn't have snow. We did not eat apples, rather we had mangoes. We never talked about the weather because there was a polar difference, right? The West and Africa were polar different. So, yes. So now the kind of people existed in literature, she was not able to identify. All these people looked to be something imaginary, something that they did not exist in real life. So that was a kind of, and at the same time, there was a kind of difference that they and us. So a concept of otherness was there, that only these people can exist in literature. And she became a kind of victim, right? And she thought that she is vulnerable, that, okay, I'm not a woman. So that kind of otherness is there. So what, this was the negative impact of those kinds of stories. And this went on because she studied in an English medium school and did not have anything else except these stories, like Cinderella kind of stories. Then one fine day, now things changed when I discovered African books. So this is called Volta. This technique is called Volta. Volta in literary genre or literary parlance means something which brings some kind of turning point in your life. So she discovered few African books by African authors, right? Of course, there were not many, but some existed. And what kind of changes they brought in, let us see. So this is the text, and I would like to give the annotation. So the next para starts with but. So as you all know, as a part of grammar, that whenever we introduce any sentence with but, then the following expression is going to be in contrast with whatever we have spoken earlier. So you see that American and British books, there are no names of people. So it's a kind of general expression, very generic kind of expression. But when she talks about Chinua Achebe and Kamara Lai, she brings people. So human aspects are there. And who are these people? This is Chinua Achebe, and this is Kamara Lai. When we talk about Chinua Achebe, he is famous for his African trilogy, Things Fall Apart, No Longer at Ease, and Arrow of God. And because of his powerful writing, his dominant writing, he received the International Man Booker Award in 2007. And his work, Adichie was very much impressed by the works of Chinua Achebe. Later on, Chinua Achebe went on writing some other books, including The Ant Hill of Savannah. So these are all very good books. And when we talk about Kamara Lai, he wrote one book called The African Child. So it's a very famous work and very popular across the African continent. So when these things became the part of her reading. Her life had a kind of epiphany, some revelation, some kind of metamorphosis in her love, that she started connecting herself with the environment, with the locale, the setting, the antagonist, the protagonist, and other characters. She started believing that girls with skin of color of chocolate, kinky hair, can exist in literature. It's not that, you know, all people with white hair or you, what we call it, blonde and all, they only exist in literature. But she thought that she could also exist in literature, and people like her also could exist in literature. So it was a kind of wonderful revelation for her. And now, the next line, which I have, you know, underlined in purple. Now, I love those American and British books I read. So it is not something I stopped reading the books from America and Britain. I still continued with them, but I added. So there was nothing like competition that, yes, the American and British books versus African books. It was American and British books with African books. So there is no competition, rather there is complementarity. So they stirred my imagination. It is something like I can see the things around me, but there are the things which are beyond my reach. So how would I come to know about them? Definitely through books. And these are the books through which I have come across the world beyond my reach. So they opened up new worlds for me. So it was nothing like closing, rather it was opening. And now the thing is that it saved me from having a single story of what books are. So it's a kind of hero connotation, in that something saves. Hero is somebody who saves others. So this is called hero connotation, right? So now again, she professes her background, that she does not belong to an elite class. Rather, she had a very humble kind of upbringing. Like her father was a professor, her mother was an administrator, and unlike India, I mean, they are underpaid, right? So still, they had a better life. They were like, it was a kind of middle class family, but they had got a better life as compared to the majority of the demograph or population. And there, she recalls a person whose name was Fide. Means they had hired the services of one boy, house boy, and his name was Fide. Why does she recall the name of Fide? Has a kind of connotation. I would like to take you a couple of minutes back when Mr. Pradeep introduced this particular discourse. He dropped one name, a drama by Shakespeare, that is The Tempest. There she talks about, Shakespeare talks about Prospero. Prospero is the master. Now he comes to that land and finds a local person over there, right? And his name is Caliban. But Prospero never calls him by his name, though he has a name. He would always call Caliban as the son of a witch, right? For the perception of a European, for a non-European black, is that he is a son of a witch, right? So just to tell that he has a name. His name was Fide. See the sentence structure. She could have vaguely said that we had a houseboy, but the purpose was that his name was Fide. Means he was a human being. And the kind of notion the family members had about free day was that yes, she belonged to a poor family, and the family had to support them. All right, so this is how Adichie's family, and especially Adichie, had a kind of pity for that boy Fide, because that Fide's family was a poor. That was the single story she had. And how did it all change when this family visited that boy's family one fine day, and they saw that they had made a beautiful basket by dyed raffia. So you could see it. So it's a beautiful creation. So she was amazed to see that why do people not tell that these people are capable of doing something? Why do people say that they are poor? Right, that's the single story that love. So that's the single story. The poverty is single story. That the kind of encounter he had with an American roommate was very shocking. Now, a couple of minutes we saw that she named the houseboy as Fide, right? A houseboy, right? Domestic help. But she was her roommate, so she could have used the name, but she does not use the name because it was not her perception that the Africans are like that. Rather, it was a common American, perception that yes, all Africans are poor, they are illiterate, they need to be saved, right? Something like that. So when her roommate talked to her, she was amazed that she was able to fluently communicate in very chaste English. And another shock upon surprise was that when Adichie told that English is our official language, no American could believe that a country, and a far-flung country in Africa, can have this kind of thing. So now you see, she asked if she could listen to what she called my tribal music. So this is a kind of alienism. She. So she is separating herself, trying to be away from her. Okay. And when she asked for, all right, fine, English, that's good, but tell me something about your tribal music. Again, a racist preoccupation. And, Adichie disappointed by producing Mariah Carey's album before her. So you all know who Mariah Carey is, and she is known for her albums We Belong Together and Without You, Bye Bye. These are her famous numbers, right? And she was shocked to see that these people whom the American pop culture too, right? And she before meeting Adichie, her roommate had developed a kind of preoccupation or a kind of bias that she is a Nigerian, not Nigerian, African. She was an African, she could not distinct between Nigeria and Africa, right? For anything from Africa is just African for them. So this patronizing feeling was a kind of pity. Yeah, she is African, like that. So she had a single story of Africa. And what was that single story? No possibility. No, there are three repetitions of no possibility. So repetition of negative. So hopelessness that these people cannot be human equals, that they cannot be ever equal to Europeans or Americans. Right? So this is a repetition of also it's a rhetorical device. So now, after a few years, he lived in America as an African. You know, for her, it was difficult to tell that, yes, I am from, Nigeria. Like, she wanted to establish her Nigerian identity, but everybody said, yes, you are African. It happens in India also. Anybody coming from the southern part of, say, somebody comes from Karnataka or somebody comes from Telangana, we simply label South Indian. It happens everywhere. So it was also a kind of labeling that African. Okay, so I believe there are 54 countries in Africa. So she started realizing that her roommate's response or reaction to Adichie was not singular. Rather, it was a kind of collective feeling that the people of America had for the thing. And what was that perception? Beautiful landscape, forest.
Sagar sir.
And yes, sir.
We have 10 minutes more.
Thank you very much. I will try to adhere to the time limit. Thank you. So whatever things we see on National Geography or Animal Planet, that is Africa. So Africa can never make a show on Star World, something like that. So this was the brighter side, that yes, nature's gift, Africa. And people waging senseless wars on each other, one tribe fighting with another, malnourished, dying people, illiteracy, and AIDS, poverty. This is the picture of Africa. And on top of it, a savior syndrome is there, that unless a white foreigner goes there, these people cannot be protected. So a savior complex, a savior syndrome is there, that yes, we are far more superior than you Africans. So that is the danger of a single story. Now, how is this single story created? So she gives an illustration that she visited Mexico, and it was the time of political tension. And in most of the media, these Mexicans, you have anything happens, that anything wrong happens, it's Mexican. So you see, these Mexicans have been dehumanized. And you see, there are, when I underline that sort of thing, so you see, the who are policing the healthcare system, sneaking across the border, being arrested at the border, that sort of thing, means a list of endless accusations. So this was something perceived through various stories, right? That was a kind of single story for her. But when one fine day she visited Guadalajara and she saw people, she was overwhelmed with guilt and shame that whatever she had read, whatever she had heard through top-notch discussions, almost was a kind of rejection. So there was a world difference between the reality and the single story. So now we come to the concluding part of this. So this is almost the gist of the presentation, and in the legal parlance, res ipsa locutur, I don't need to interpret them. Still, I would like to highlight the stylistic part. So that is how to create a single story. Show a people as one thing, as only one thing. If something is shown as one thing, it's not a danger. But if it is shown as only one thing, then there is a danger. And I love these lines. Stories matter. Many stories matter. Stories have been used to dispossess and to malign. But stories can also be used to empower and humanize. Stories can break the dignity of a people, but stories can also repair that broken dignity. So I would like to take the liberty that I would not be interpreting these lines because they are self-explanatory, and the kind of gathering I have is very much learned. So I would skip the, interpreting this and jump to the next part. The American writer, Alice Walker, who is known for her magnum opus, The Color Purple, who is also a great feminist writer and who introduced one word, womanist. She saw that the word feminist is now taken as a pejorative word, so she introduced a new word called womanist. So she talks about the relations between the southern relative and who moved to north, right? Because of one thing or the other. And she adequately uses, they sat around reading the book themselves, listening to me read the book, and the kind of paradise was regained. So the purpose of using direct speech is multifarious. Suppose I'm telling you a dialogue from Julius Caesar. When I say "et tu, Brute," it's in direct speech. It would have a greater impact than if I had said it in indirect speech, right? So here one expression is used: paradise was regained. So I would read this and come to its introduction here. I would like to end with this thought that when we reject the single story, when we realize that there is never a single story about any place, we regain a kind of paradise. Actually, this has got a literary allusion. John Milton, a famous Elizabethan poet, I believe Jacobean poet, wrote an epic called Paradise Lost. It runs into 12 books. And the concluding book is called Paradise Regained. So Paradise Lost is the story of the fall of man, right, according to biblical and Hebraic connotation. And Paradise Regained is again getting salvation. So if we reject the single story, when we realize that there is never a single story about any place, we regain a kind of paradise. So like there are many stories which are not written. So in the words of Kabir, tu kehta kagat ki lekhi, main kehta aankhan ki dekhi. There are many stories which are not written. We have to see it through our own eyes. So behind every book is a man, and behind the man is the race, and behind the race are the natural and social environment whose influence is unconsciously reflected. This is very much true about any story. And before I conclude, I would say that we live with stories. First, story is introduced us for entertainment. Secondly, stories are introduced to us for education. And third, we live with stories with for life and for profession. Thank you very much. And your valuable questions would enrich this discourse. I would like to welcome your questions.
Thank you so much, Jeevan Sagar sir. This was a really wonderful presentation. When we say stylistic interpretation or approach to literature, it is like in the language of Sir Francis Bacon, it is like too many sectories, that is, in a way, hair splitters, right? So you have very aptly and in a very detailed manner, you have explained how this almost half an hour lecture has turned into a great textbook for us to read. And so I would like to thank you for that. And as we come to the okay, so now we will move to the question and answer session. As of now, I have a question for you. The question is from Dr. Yamla Paparao, and he asks, single stories have the power to tell false interpretation of the actual story. Do you agree? And if so, throw some light.
Thank you very much, sir. It's I should say that if this question would had not come, this entire discourse would have been incomplete. In Marxist parlance, there is an expression called ISA. Intellectual, let me recall. Yeah, intellectual state apparatus. There are two kinds of apparatuses, like repressive state apparatus, which are police, army, and power. And when we talk about ISA, intellectual state apparatus, so these are educational system, media, press. So the ruler, the system tries to influence people's thoughts through the intellectual method, where power is not possible, where shackles are not possible. It tries to control the brain of the people, and the stories are the powerful source of it. So when a single story is projected in all possible media, so people think that yes, this is the single thing which is happening, and it becomes a bias. And this is all happening today. We are all victims of single story.
Okay, so Parvez sir, is there any question on your part?
No sir.
Okay, great. So as we move to the as we move close to the end of this session, I would like to call upon our Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. V.C.B. Vivekanandan, for his concluding remarks.
Well, thank you. I was most part I was here, and so I have to talk Jeevan Sagar's story from the most part I was sitting here, right? So some part of his story I didn't hear. That's another problem. That even if it is a single story, at times we don't hear the full story, So there's another way of looking at it. But as you said that probably today was the tender business was going on or sitting, I was really regretting because more than any law session, I love to attend literature session, right? Because my things have always been on stories. And then probably, I chickened out not to make my living as a story writer. I got into other profession. And so always I always have an anguish that I didn't go into literature. But it's good to sit today to listen. And somewhere I thought probably this is too crucial for lawyers who often tend to do this to tell a single story because that is what the act says, that's what the section says. Right, but interestingly, the same act, same sections, two lawyers are talking two different stories to a judge. And add some amicus curiae, you'll have another story coming in, right? So what in a way to reflect upon is, there is a lot of stories, and when you talk justice for all, probably you have to hear a lot of stories. And it cannot be one story which you call as the dominant story. Even though there are many stories, one becomes a dominant story. This is a very vexatious part of life in everywhere, you know, and as part of social sciences, there used to be a big movement called subaltern studies, which came up in the 70s, 80s. So when at that time, I'm also graduating, and it was a very interesting area to go through, I really don't see. But increasingly, I'm connecting today, it's a single story. It's a single story many times in the discourse. And most importantly, I call it dominant media story, quite often what we hear. And probably if you happen to be in Arnab Goswami's show, it'll be only a single story, right? In other places, there'll be little murmur, you know. So this is really, really alarming in a way that, are we as a society slowly moving, you know, in many walks. As I said, there were, this is not something new. And historically, as I said, there will be a dominant story. And other stories which are discarded or doesn't make the cut quite often. But today, if you think that nobody else wants to tell a story, then I don't know what kind of robotic humanity which we are heading towards. So that should be my reflection. As I said that, but if I come across, it was wonderful to listen to Mr. Jeevan, not just taking this concept, but with this very, very innovative slides, trying to, you know, explain. So I was keenly reading the comments and, you know, things in the thing. Then I realized how many books, how many pages I've read without, you know, really knowing so much sometimes in these pages and lines. Or is that what they call reading in between the lines? I really don't know. So I would like to stop at this. And Professor Yogendra can have some comments. And then if others have no questions, I am through with my from my end.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Jeevan Sagarji and other faculty members present this important webinar session. It is little interesting, though I am not a literature person, but I have gone through with the different critics. It is available on website, different social media. And if you will go through with that critic, as well as we will see your today's presentation, it is awesome. It is really on a literature front, you have defined everything. But if we will, as a law person, if we will connect the whole thing, because we are talking about biases, we are talking about justice, then we will see what she wants to communicate. Even in July 2009, when this TED talk was delivered by her, and she argues that inherent in the power of stories is a danger, the danger of only knowing one part of the story, one part of a group. And that's why if we are talking about that section, that story, either if we will connect this, the whole this TED talk in a contemporary world, then we will see there are number of stories either in media or in social media handles we have, but we can connect easily with the few important examples. And in Western countries, we have already developed the connect, which is missing in India as well as in Asian region specifically. Why I am sharing this? There is a connect of a law in literature in Western countries, Europe, as well as in Australia. You will see in all law schools, they are focusing more and more on law in literature, law in culture, law in religion, law in society, and law in psychology. And law and language. This is basically already developed a very important paper in all law schools. And if we will connect, and in the old drama, Merchant of Venice, wrote by William Shakespeare, even there is a law. There is a law, it was present in that drama itself. But in our classes, sometimes we are not connecting. I am already infused whatever you have mentioned between the lines. You narrated everything related to language, grammar, literature. It is very much there. But as and when we are connecting with law, it is basically she wants to communicate the title danger in course implies that sticking to this single story slash idea will lead to negative outcomes, which we do in fact see in the world today. Basically, this is unawareness has created a disconnect between the people of different cultures, in fact. And it is missing in India. We will see there is a disconnect between the different religious persons. There is a disconnect between Hindu and Muslims and Isai, Christian. And if we will see the Western countries, even in Israel, there is a disconnect between the people. And what exactly she wants to communicate, this is the time to connect ourselves and not rely only on one story. That's why there is an importance even today, after more than 20 years, more than 11, 12 years, we can say there is a relevancy of this TED Talk. We should communicate. We will discuss on this front as well. And definitely you have done good justice with the whole TED Talk, which is now, I mean, it is not available in text, but you relied specifically on text and delivered in such a way easily we can understand. Thank you very much, Jeevan. It is very beautifully discussed today in this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
It becomes very special when it comes from such two legends. For me, it's really great privilege for me. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor for his vision of sui generis and everyone else for making room in their busy schedule to attend this webinar. Thank you and stay safe. Now I pass the mic to the host. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Pradeep, sir. So, Jeevan sir says about a talk about single story. We know that everybody has a single story to tell. It is not only about what happened in Nigeria and in America. In India, we have everybody has a single story to tell. So I'm not taking up much time. I just thank Vice Chancellor sir for his concluding remark. I thank Jeevan Sagar sir and Pradeep Barman sir for conducting this webinar. With these words, I just with the permission of the chair, I would like to declare this session concluded. Thank you so much.
Thank you.